Bienvenidos a la Cátedra de Refugiados y Migrantes Forzosos Inditex de la Universidad Pontificia Comillas. Guerras, conflictos, estados fallidos, cambio climático, catástrofes naturales... Las causas de la movilidad forzada son muy diversas y se dan en todo el mundo. Nuestra cátedra, en línea con los valores de la universidad, trabaja para conocer de manera académica las distintas situaciones, reconocer sus causas y procesos y proponer respuestas. El estudio de las cifras, de desplazados y un correcto análisis de ellas contextualiza, nos ayuda a entender nuestro mundo. Hay 79,5 millones de personas desplazadas a la fuerza, 26 millones de refugiados y 4,2 millones de solicitantes de asilo. Refugiados y migrantes forzosos son uno de los colectivos que mejor representan las tensiones y oportunidades del nuevo escenario global. Desde un contacto permanente con los diferentes agentes sociales que trabajan en este campo, la cátedra empuja para cerrar las brechas, dar voz y desestigmatizar la figura del refugiado y del migrante, y convertir las crisis en oportunidades.
Seminario Migración. Este, pues, como todos saben, es el último seminario de esta séptima edición y lo cerramos con el título Mapping the Integration of Refugee and Migrant Children in Europe, y tiene una lógica porque viene de la mano del proyecto INMERS, que está liderado por el Instituto Universitario de Estudios sobre Migraciones desde el año 2018. Este es un proyecto, el proyecto INMERS, que está destinado a la infancia, es decir, está destinado a nuestro futuro, a la manera en la que nosotros nos vamos a ver reflejados en el mañana. Todos los países europeos se ven afectados por las recientes tendencias migratorias y uno de los retos fundamentales para la Unión Europea consiste en integrar con éxito a estos recién llegados, así como a las poblaciones migrantes más antiguas y a sus descendientes. Las escuelas, los centros de acogida de inmigrantes de toda Europa y los responsables políticos necesitan urgentemente recomendaciones políticas para apoyar a los niños inmigrantes. El objetivo general de INMERS es ofrecer una imagen representativa de la realidad nacional y europea sobre la integración de los niños refugiados y migrantes para elaborar documentos políticos con recomendaciones específicas que fomenten sociedades diversas e inclusivas. Por ello, INMERS pretende incorporar a todas las partes interesadas, es decir, niños, familias, investigadores, ONGs, responsables políticos, educadores e instituciones de aprendizaje en la creación conjunta y la validación de un cuadro de indicadores. Para alcanzar estos objetivos del proyecto, como ven, un proyecto bastante ambicioso, los niños y otras partes interesadas han participado en actividades de co-creación en fases clave del proceso de investigación y de forma de decisiones. Los principales resultados del proyecto son la creación conjunta de un panel de indicadores sobre la integración de los niños inmigrantes y refugiados, un programa en línea para la recogida de datos y un conjunto de recomendaciones y buenas prácticas nacionales y de la Unión Europea sobre la integración de los niños refugiados e inmigrantes en Europa. La metodología cualitativa para la co-creación del tablero de indicadores incluyó talleres con niños y partes interesadas para identificar los resultados intermedios y finales, dando prioridad a sus experiencias expresadas y a su empoderamiento. Siguiendo, pues, este marco de investigación, los investigadores de INMERS han recopilado datos relacionados con esos indicadores de 23.000 niños entre los 6 y los 18 años de 6 países europeos, 13.000 de ellos de origen inmigrante, en países como Bélgica, Alemania, Grecia, Irlanda, Italia y España, empleando tanto la recopilación de datos de encuestas como la investigación cualitativa con poblaciones a las que era más difícil llegar, como los menores no acompañados, por ejemplo. Un perfil sobre el que hay que poner especial cuidado por la vulnerabilidad por la que atraviesa. El análisis de los datos ofrece así una imagen representativa de esta realidad nacional y europea en materia de integración de los niños refugiados y migrantes. Y a continuación, mi compañera Raquel, de la Cátedra de Refugiados, nos va a presentar un poquito más el marco en el que se presenta esta ponencia. Gracias.
Gracias a ti, Cecilia. Bueno, damos la bienvenida a Rihanna Mayer. La dinámica de la sesión va a ser que Rihanna nos va a explicar durante unos 50 minutos pues el programa IMERS y cómo ella lo ha realizado, cómo lo realiza desde Irlanda, que es donde la tenemos hoy. Y bueno, le damos la bienvenida y posteriormente tendremos un turno de preguntas para el público y tenemos el chat habilitado para todos los que estéis online, para las preguntas que puedan surgir. Bueno, pues bienvenida, Rihanna. Rihanna Mayer es investigadora postdoctoral en la Escuela de Estudios Sociales Aplicados y el Instituto de Ciencias Sociales del Siglo XXI de la University College Cork. Es licenciada en Sociología, máster en Sociología y doctora en Educación. Sus áreas de interés son la sociología, la educación, la política educativa, las políticas relacionadas con la infancia, el acceso a la educación y la equidad. La migración y la integración también forman parte de su formación y los estudios sobre la infancia. Ha realizado investigaciones en Reino Unido, en Canadá y en Irlanda. El título de la ponencia que nos va a presentar hoy son las lecciones de co-creación en la investigación cuantitativa a gran escala con niños migrantes. Pues bienvenida, Rihanna. En su ponencia nos va a explicar cómo es importante tener la opinión o la participación de los niños en la investigación y cómo el derecho en la toma de decisiones afectará en sus vidas y cómo esto viene recogido también en las Naciones Unidas en la Convención de los Derechos del Niño. Cada vez es más aceptado comprender que las condiciones de los niños prosperan las experiencias y las voces y deben estar en primera línea de la investigación y la política. En esta presentación se hablará de la co-creación de los niños inmigrantes en el contexto de IMERS, Integration Mapping of Refugees and Migrant Children, un proyecto de investigación a gran escala de Horizon 2020, centrado en la integración socioeducativa de niños refugiados e inmigrantes en los 6 países europeos que nos ha dicho Cecilia antes, en Alemania, Grecia, Irlanda, Italia, España y Bélgica. En primer lugar, se revisará toda la bibliografía sobre la investigación cooperativa con los niños, prestando especial atención al uso de grupos asesores de investigación infantil. A continuación, Rihanna nos ofrecerá una visión general del proyecto, destacando la participación de los niños migrantes durante las diversas etapas y bueno, explorando los enfoques co-creativos que han empleado. Por último, reflexionará, y reflexionaremos todos, sobre el potencial de la co-creación en contextos de proyectos a gran escala y las lecciones que han aprendido en el proyecto IMERS a través de la participación de los más pequeños, de los niños. Así que bienvenida, Rihanna, puedes empezar. Estamos muy contentos de tenerte con nosotras.
I'm going to assume you said only nice things about me there. shall I start? Shall I share my screen?
Sí, puedes empezar, sin problema.
Right. Thank you so much for having me to be part of this seminar series. Thank you especially to Cecilia and Raquel for helping to get everything arranged. Thank you to my colleagues from the IMERS project who are at Comillas for suggesting to invite UCC to be a part of this series. And of course, thank you to everyone who's attending. I very much appreciate your forbearance with having me via Zoom instead of in person. I got to meet some of you in December when I was on an Erasmus visit there, and I would have loved to have been able to be there in person today, but unfortunately other commitments wouldn't allow it. I also very much appreciate your forbearance with having the session in English. My Spanish is limited to saying por favor and gracias and donde está la biblioteca. I also really want to acknowledge the work of my colleagues at UCC, although I am presenting here today, they have laid a lot of the foundations of what's going to be talked about in the session today with their work on children's voice and participation and their expertise in the use of children's research advisory groups. So that's Dr. Shirley Martin, Dr. Deirdre Horgan, and Dr. Jackie O'Riordan. Okay, so the presentation today is going to focus on co-creative research with children. We'll review a bit of the key literature on that, starting with some of the foundations in the discourse of children's rights. I'll look at a few different models that have been proposed for children's participation in research. And then I'll talk about the use of advisory groups, which, as I said, is an area of expertise here at UCC. Then I'll get into the Immerse project and the co-creation activities that we used as part of that. I'll talk about children's roles first as participants in the research, then as co-creators, and finally focusing again on the work of the advisory group. In the final section, I'll be reflecting on our experiences with Immerse and our co-creational activities. I'll be looking at what I think were some of the strengths of our approach and our practice, but also in the context of the challenges of doing co-creative research in this kind of large-scale, multi-partner, multinational kind of project, and looking at looking to the future to see how we can improve even on the practice that we've done in the Immerse project. So first, review of some co-creative research with children, some of the literature on that. The foundation for this, for children's participation in research as more than just the objects of research, really comes from the discourse and the practical application of children's rights and children's citizenship. Advocates of children's rights and citizenship argue that rights of protection and provision are not enough. Even if we don't grant children equal status with adults, they still need rights of participation to have a voice in decision-making that affects their lives. And perhaps nowhere is this commitment to children's rights articulated so clearly as in the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. This is the leading international statement on children's rights adopted by the UN in 1989. It was ratified in Spain in 1990 and in Ireland in 1992. It is the most agreed on human rights statement in the world, even more than the original Universal Declaration of 1948. The specific rights that are in the convention are related to health, education, family life, play and recreation, adequate standard of living, and protection from abuse and harm. But there are four general principles that underpin all of the 42 specific rights that are in the charter. The first is non-discrimination, having the right to develop potential in all situations at all times for every child. The second is the best interests of the child, which must be a primary consideration in all actions and decisions regarding them. And this also can be used to resolve conflicts between different rights. Third is the right to survival and development, and this underscores the vital importance of ensuring access to basic services and to equality of opportunity. And then finally, the views of the child. And this means that the voices of children must be heard and respected in all matters concerning themselves and their rights. And so along with the ideas of children as citizens, as social agents, and their right to participation, that it comes a responsibility for those who conduct research with children to reconceptualize children's relationship to research and to researchers. Certainly research on children is nothing new, but this new paradigm in the construction of children as social actors and as rights bearers necessitates a different approach for researchers. Research for children, research with children, rather than just research on children. Moreover, once we recognize children as agents that have particular needs and viewpoints, it becomes apparent that research on children has a rather glaring deficit. It's missing children's knowledge and understanding of themselves, of the others in their lives, of their relationships to them, and of their world. So when we exclude children from the process of research, we have a very incomplete account from a scientific perspective of what it is that causes any person, adult or child, to act as they do. It's therefore becoming accepted that to understand the conditions under which children thrive, their experiences and voices must be at the forefront of research and policy. Or to put it in another locational metaphor, we must find ways to bring children into the center of the research process to create knowledge about children with children. So from a researcher understanding perspective, which is critical for good policy, children's participation isn't just a nice thing to do, it's a necessary thing to do. Moreover, certain cohorts of children tend to be less well heard, quite often because they have additional vulnerabilities. And ironically, it's sometimes out of a sense of protection that these children can be silenced in research and policy because they're thought to be too vulnerable to exercise their rights and express their voice, and so become excluded from decision-making, with adults instead acting on their behalf. And chief among these lesser heard voices are children who are from migrant backgrounds, particularly if they are in the asylum seeking process. So even though children have been part of migration flows for, as long as there have been migration flows, both when traveling alone and when traveling with family or relatives, there are few policies at national or international level that deal specifically with child migration. And those that do often have very little input from children and young people themselves. So what does it mean to co-create knowledge? Ramaswamy and Ozcan offer this definition: joint creation and evolution of value with stakeholding individuals, intensified and inactive through platforms of engagement, virtualized and emergent from ecosystems of capabilities, and actualized and embodied in domains of experiences, expanding wealth, welfare, well-being. There's an awful lot going on there in that definition. A more simple way of putting it might be collaborative knowledge generation, but it entails more than that. It involves some attempt to engage in the whole process those who have a stake in the outcome, to balance the relationships between the different groups involved, the researchers, the participants, the people who will be affected by the outcomes of the research. It involves the attempt to make the process transparent and inclusive, to ground the process and the outcomes in the lived experiences, again, of those who will be affected, and to aim to improve things for them. So co-creation involves quite a lot in our conception of it, particularly in a social research, from a social research perspective. Co-creation can take different forms, so we'll look at a few of the different models of participation that have been put forward. One of the earliest is Hart's Ladder, which was developed in the early 1990s by Roger Hart and published by UNICEF. It categorizes different levels of children's involvement on a scale of 8 rungs. You can see in the image there. So at the bottom is manipulation, then decoration, tokenism, and then rung 4, assigned but informed, then consulted and informed, adult initiated but shared decisions, youth initiated and directed, and then finally at the top, youth initiated decision sharing with adults. As you can see, the bottom 3 rungs are in red, and the words that are used to describe those rungs are emphatically negative. And Hart actually initially described these levels as levels of non-participation rather than participation. So from there, the implicit idea is that every rung you move upwards on the ladder represents greater participation, which is inherently better, and the top level is sort of what researchers should be striving for. I'm not sure that that's what Hart and UNICEF originally had in those specific sort of implications are what they had in mind. I think what they really wanted was just to get researchers sort of off of the bottom levels and to consider, to put much more consideration into the way that children might be involved in research. This model and others like it, like Shire's Pathways, they were very influential and actually continue to be very influential, especially Hart's Ladder. But they have come in for their fair share of criticism on theoretical and practical grounds. The fact that the models are visualized as ladders or pathways indicates, a linear sequence of discrete steps, towards 2, an ideal level of participation to be reached. This assumes that participation activities fall neatly into one of the levels, and also that the highest level is the most desirable level. However, there are scholars that have argued that the reality of power and decision-making dynamics in research are much more complex and fluid than would be reflected in a model like this, making the assignment of any particular project or activity to one rung of the ladder likely to be inaccurate. Moreover, it's important that we don't take for granted that more research is automatically better than less, that youth-initiated and shared decision-making should be the aspiration of all research involving children. We must be critical always of the circumstances of inclusion and participation, we have to acknowledge and interrogate both the risks and the practicalities of participation, as well as the potential benefits, both for the researchers and the young children who would be involved. A more recent model, and one that informed the work that we did on Immerse, comes from Franks, who is a UK scholar that does research with young refugees, and what she calls pockets of participation. She argues that pure participation, certainly in the context of research in the UK, has largely remained a unicorn. It doesn't exist. And that therefore, we might profitably look for ways in which involvement can be maximized that are both meaningful and actually practical and achievable. So instead of trying to incorporate participation into all levels and aspects of the research process, which may not be feasible or even appropriate, she suggests developing participative ownership of specific facets of the research process so that participants become stakeholders in the research rather than owners of it in total. So in that approach, the critical element would be identifying the pockets of participation, and that would be a negotiated process between the researchers and the young people. It would be a discussion to decide on what facets will be undertaken and what kind of support or capacity building is needed. Another more recent model that informed the co-creation on Immerse is the Lundy model, and this responds directly to Article 12 of the UNCRC. Laura Lundy is a legal scholar from Queen's Belfast and also part-time at UCC now. And there are four elements to this, which are space, voice, audience, and influence. Space is both literal and metaphorical. It's about giving children a safe and inclusive opportunities to form and express their views. Voice is about how children can be facilitated to express their views. Audience is about who is listening. There's little point in giving children the space and facilitation to express their views if no one is listening. Influence is about how what is being expressed will be acted upon. Lundy argues that there are significant areas of overlap between these four elements, but that there is a chronological order. Space, which is the opportunity to express views, must come first, and the rest will follow. Although once the process has been initiated, it can then proceed in a cyclical kind of way. This model has become very influential in policy circles and has been adopted by a number of organizations and government departments in the UK, in Ireland, by the UN, by the European Commission, amongst others, in their child participation strategies. So that's models. What about methods? Navigating approaches to research that respect children as agents and seeks to co-produce knowledge with them is a real challenge. And there's currently sort of limited methodological research on how to involve children effectively in co-creation activities. Much of the examples of research that we have that embrace a co-creative approach to research involving children, or that try to at least, employ methods that are participatory, creative, and usually qualitative. So qualitative and creative methods like observation, interviews, role play, art-based methods, journaling, etc. These allow for much greater interaction and facilitation between the young person and the researcher. There's more scope for reducing the power imbalances. There's flexibility to adapt the methods to the young people, to their interests, to their level of development, and to their own modes of meaning making. But though qualitative and creative methods are generally preferred for research involving children, there are advantages to data collected with quantitative methods, especially on a large scale, that are difficult, if not impossible, to replicate using qualitative and creative methods. Unfortunately, the conditions that make for good quant data collection are precisely the things that make it less amenable to co-creation. Research undertaken to determine patterns at a population level require data on a large scale that is representative and comparable. So design and method are highly shaped by data harmonization considerations. Standard design, standard methods, standard instruments, standard collection procedures to provide more control over the comparability of the resulting data. But that standardization and control tends to mean that self-expression is much more restricted, and that a certain level of cognitive development is needed to interact with those kinds of methods, and that the social relationships and the processes involved tend to remain quite hierarchical. However, because of the advantages of large-scale quantitative methods, because of the questions that you can answer at a population level using that kind of data collection, combined with the acknowledged importance of children's voice and experience in research, we are seeing efforts to adapt those kinds of methods involving children increasing, especially where there is an interest in policy formation. One of the methods that has that is gaining in visibility and that has been promoted and advocated as a method that has a lot of potential for children's participation and for co-creation is the use of children's advisory groups in research. In the context of such a group, children are not the research subjects, but rather informants and researchers who occupy a space for thinking about research. So the really important distinction that they're not being asked to speak directly about their experiences, that what they are offering is not data for the purposes of the research, but rather they're acting as an expert group to reflect on the experiences of children in general, particularly if they represent a particular population that we're trying to understand, and so they represent their peers in this process. There's sort of limited literature on the use of advisory groups, but what we do have, and quite a lot of it has been written by my colleagues at UCC, outlines the benefits of using such children and young people's advisory groups. They're really great at identifying important topics that are relevant to young people and to children, providing advice to ensure that the methods that we're using to carry out our research are relative and appropriate for the population that we're interested in studying, identifying key findings, again, that are relevant and important to them, and making recommendations and policy priorities arising from those findings, as well as identifying means to disseminate the results of the research that, again, are going to be relevant and accessible for themselves and their peers. And so this literature demonstrates how using these advisory groups can really boost the quality and the credibility of the research. It is important, however, that the benefits, we don't only consider the benefits to the research, we have to consider the benefits to the young people involved as well. And the kind of benefits that have been documented are things like the opportunity to have voice heard. So providing that space and that voice, those two elements of the Lundy model, and potentially also audience and influence as well. But more personal benefits that might arise out of participating in such a group are increased confidence, enhanced critical thinking skills, research skills, and other kinds of capacity building. So why isn't everyone using children's research advisory groups all the time, everywhere? Well, it's because the realities of working with an advisory group are actually very complex and challenging. It involves a lot of negotiation, both with gatekeepers and with the young people themselves. Even just getting a group set up can be a challenge, defining the roles and responsibilities, deciding how the recruitment is going to be done. You know, who is going to be recruited is going to be quite specific in order to represent a certain population. There's the issue of what knowledge and skills the children coming in to participate have, and is there any training required? Is there any capacity building that's needed? Why have they joined the group? You know, to, have their parents made them do it? Did a teacher suggest it? Or, you know, do they actually have an interest in participating? And there's all kinds of logistical things that need to be worked out, arranging meetings, restrictions on the number and frequency of meetings, transportation. And then there's also important ethical questions that need to be asked, and that need to be asked as an ongoing conversation. As long as the advisory group is active, those ethical questions about the power dynamics in the partnerships between the researcher and the young people involved, ongoing consent. So that is definitely not just something that is taken care of right at the beginning. That is definitely an ongoing process throughout the life of the group. And some key elements that help make advisory groups successful, as discussed in the literature, are attention to recruitment, building rapport, clear organization and communication, and the use of multiple methods of engagement. In terms of recruitment, representation and intersectionality emerge as very important. We can't just use children as research advisors just because they're children. That's conceptually simplistic and methodologically flawed. So what you want is to have as close a match as possible between the children we want to understand and the children who are acting as experts in the advisory group. And that will give you a richer quality of feedback to inform the research. Time for relational development is also very important, both among the group members and between the members and the research team. That's really critical for building trust and rapport, and again, will result in a richer dialogue. Creating a child-friendly meeting environment throughout the process, as far as that is practical and possible, having facilitators who are not only experts in conducting research with children, but also have some kind of knowledge about the lives of these children, again, as far as that is practical and possible. And so in our case, that was children of migrant and refugee backgrounds. Organization and communication needs to be very clear and needs to account for any barriers that might result, particularly when dealing with children from migrant backgrounds. So language barriers, having access to avenues of communication, so electronic communication like email or like text or WhatsApp, that kind of thing. Having access just to stable internet could be an issue. And then as well as transportation considerations and costs. The complex time and resources that it takes to run an advisory group could make people reluctant to try and incorporate them into their research, but there are ways of counterbalancing these things. And as I said, it can be an incredibly invaluable addition to your research. Okay, so that's a sort of a whirlwind tour of the literature. We're going to go into Immerse now and talk about the co-creation activities that we did in the context of this project. But a quick overview of the project first. I think there was actually, well, I'll go through this very fast. So I think there was quite an overview given at the beginning of the session. This is a five-year project. It was 4 years, but then, you know, global pandemic. Funded by the European Commission under Horizon 2020, we're a consortium of 11 partners in 6 countries. The project aim is to measure the socio-educational integration of migrant and refugee children in Europe in their new schools. The project involves researchers in all 6 of the countries gathering data from the relevant stakeholders, but particularly from migrant and refugee children themselves of school-going age, so age 7 to 18. The 6 countries involved in Immerse are Spain, Ireland, Belgium, Germany, Italy, and Greece. Our consortium is made up of universities, NGOs, departments of education, IT specialists, a project management company. There's so many of us. The project coordinators are located in Spain at Comillas, and I am part of the Irish team located in Cork at University College Cork. The project has a number of outputs, the main ones I've listed on the screen here. The first output was a dashboard of 30 key indicators of socio-educational integration, and that was the result of the first year's worth of work on the project. And much of the rest of the work is based on the foundation of this dashboard. We've also put together a collection of 60 best practice case studies drawn from all of the partner countries and created an online digital database of resources for educators and policymakers that's available on our website. Following the creation of the dashboard, we created a questionnaire based on the dashboard to gather data on the indicators. And over the past year and a half, we've been collecting data from thousands of children in all six countries from migrant and from non-migrant backgrounds. This is almost finished, and there will be, when we are finished, over 25,000 children in the database, again, drawn from all of the partner countries. Plus, we will have data from the schools where the majority of data was collected. This was paralleled by qualitative case studies with groups of children who are underrepresented in the large-scale data collection. So children like unaccompanied minors, those not in formal education, those close to aging out of the system, etc. And to add to the primary quantitative data, we've mined some existing data sources like MIPEX and Eurostat for data at the macro level related to legislation and supports for migrants in each country, things like that. And then finally, based on our primary and secondary data, we'll be forming policy recommendations at national level for each of the countries and at European levels. So the project is quite ambitious in scope, and there's a lot going on in it. One of the critical ways that children were involved in the project was as participants. Now, this is not the same as informing the research process or co-creation of knowledge, but I wanted to draw attention to this for two reasons. One, I think it's really important that the contribution of the children who filled in our survey or participated in the small qualitative case studies isn't overlooked because they weren't active in designing the methods or analyzing the data. Because ultimately, it is this wealth of data from the children who acted only as participants that will provide the foundation for the policy recommendations. And I think the policy recommendations and the database are the two most important outputs that the project will produce. Second, I wanted to draw attention to the fact that we administered the questionnaires to children as young as 7 years old. It's rare for this kind of large-scale quantitative research to be done with children that young. We developed a more child-friendly version of the questionnaire for the 7 to 9-year-olds with simplified language and more basic question types, and it had visuals in it. And I can talk more about that later if you're interested. But now let's look at how children and young people were involved as co-creators in Immerse. These are the contributions of the children and the young people that didn't generate data to be analyzed, or who didn't only generate data to be analyzed, the way the participants I just spoke about did. These activities were about informing the research process, the methods, the analysis, the dissemination, and the outputs, the tools that were created. It's important to note at this point that we had basically no model or no roadmap to follow as we were going about this. Attempting to take a co-creative approach to collaborate with children and young people throughout a project of this size and this scope, especially one that depended so heavily on quantitative methods, is by no means common. So one of the early ways that children acted as co-creators was in the creation and the validation of the dashboard. As I said earlier, the dashboard of 30 key indicators of integration became a foundational tool for the qualitative and the quantitative data collection that came after it. It's divided into integration outcomes, and you can see that on the right-hand side of your screen, and integration barriers and facilitators, which I haven't pictured here. We assembled the dashboard based on the extensive literature review, but also, more importantly, through primary data collection in each of the countries with migrant children and their parents, teachers, school leaders, experts, policymakers. And I should say, actually, team at who were at Comillas were actually, and not only are they the overall project coordinators, but they were in charge of this particular phase of the research and did a fantastic job. So in this particular phase, I think of the children as being both research participants and co-creators, because we did collect data from them and analyze that data, and some papers have been published on that analysis alone, but that data has also then been used to construct tools that can be used by others, the dashboard and the questionnaire. So there were two phases to their involvement. First were the workshops during the creation phase of the dashboard. Small groups of children took part in age-specific workshops that used a variety of creative methods to explore their ideas around belonging in school. We especially like using the imagined child exercise so that the children didn't have to make themselves vulnerable by talking about their own experiences. They could choose instead to talk about an imaginary child. Older children's groups used more sophisticated activities like the Lifeline, which I can explain later if you're interested. I don't have time to go into the full process of forming the dashboard, and actually Comillas have written an article about it, so you can check that out if you're interested. But once we had a long list of the potential indicators to go into the dashboard and some questions formed to measure them, we had validation workshops with children, again divided by age, where we talked them through the items using the CARA method, which stands for clarity, adequacy, relevance, and accessibility, and gathered their feedback on what they thought was most important, if we were missing anything, if anything was unclear or confusing, and then that feedback helped informing the final version of the dashboard. The workshops to validate the dashboard actually contained our initial first drafts of the questionnaires, but these were then extensively adjusted and workshopped over the next 6 months after the dashboard was validated. Once we had a draft of the questionnaire that included good candidates for indicator questions and for demographic questions, they were workshopped by our project advisory group, which I'll talk about more in a minute. And then once we had versions that were just about ready to be put into the field, we organized pilot sessions in 4 of the 6 countries where we had groups of children representing the whole age range, 7 to 18, look over the questionnaires, try them out, and give us their feedback. They didn't need to actually complete the questionnaires with their own answers. Again, this is not about collecting data, but reviewing the instrument. And the research teams that were there to facilitate, excuse me, so the kids could ask any questions and make comments or suggestions for how to improve the instrument. And so that feedback was used then in a further round of revision before we put the questionnaire into the field. Once the large-scale survey data collection was close to finishing, each of the partners started to hold policy consultation workshops with groups of young people. In Ireland, as I think has been the case in most of the other countries, we used some of the schools that actually participated in the survey part of the project. So we gave a short presentation on what it means to do a policy consultation, why we were holding these workshops, and then ran through some of the preliminary results from both the quantitative and the qualitative data. We then did various activities with the students, like graffiti walls, World Cafe placemats, and polling to get their reactions to the results and to brainstorm ideas about how we can translate these results into recommendations for governments and for schools. These workshops are ongoing, and once they're done, they will inform the national policy papers and the EU level policy papers, which are some of the final deliverables for the project. In addition to the advisory group that's been involved since the beginning of the project, we have now also convened a special group to help us craft dissemination plans, in particular, creating child and youth-friendly versions of the results to distribute. My colleagues actually met with the group for the first time just this past Tuesday to begin the work, and there were lots of great ideas that came out of that session. artwork, cartoons, videos, like short TikTok style videos, but also longer style videos, social media platform takeovers, because IMMIRT has social media platforms available. And some of this group are also interested in participating in panels at our end of project events. There's been one group of young people that's been involved in IMMIRT since the beginning of the project, or rather since the project was funded, and that is our advisory group, Children and Young Persons Advisory Group, and I'll refer to that as the CPEG for short. I don't have time to go through all of the activities that they've done, because they've done a lot, but I'll give an overview. It was decided that there would be one advisory group for the project and that it would be based in Ireland because of the expertise of the Irish team in forming and using advisory groups. They've used them in several previous projects. And the group was formed using the UCC researchers' network of associations with refugee and migrant community groups, with which they already had long-standing relationships. It was originally 18 members, all from migrant or asylum-seeking backgrounds with a mix of ages and of genders. The CPEG has a role in peer representation of young migrants on the IMMIRT project, so ensuring that the children that we recruited were broadly representative of migrant children in Ireland, or at the very least represent children who will be at the center of the research, as in similar ages, similar backgrounds, etc., was critical to the formation of the group. In a general sense, the role of the advisory group was to advise and inform the research process to ensure its relevance and its intelligibility to refugee and migrant children. We were not asking them to tell us about their own experiences as refugee and migrant young people, but to use their experience and expertise to guide us in our research on what is essentially their peers. So what that means in practice was activities under these general headings: developing, validating, and piloting research materials, suggesting themes for qualitative data collection, data analysis, dissemination of the results, and in a meta kind of way, helping us to further develop the advisory group methodology. I don't have time to go over everything the CPEG has done, so I'll give some examples from the developing and piloting research materials and the data analysis. The CPEG piloted and gave feedback on all the activities that were used during the qualitative workshops with children during the first year of IMMIRT when we were building the dashboard. So before any of those activities or materials got to the country workshops, it was tried out and evaluated by the CPEG. The CPEG were also the first young people to test out and give feedback on the questionnaire instrument that we developed. The dashboard validation workshops had given us a good start, but the ones that we had the CPEG workshop were the more complete drafts of the questionnaire. They also used the CARA method, the clarity, adequacy, relevance, and accessibility, to review the questions and give us their feedback on them. The UCC team members were there, of course, to facilitate the session, answer any questions they had, and then gather their feedback together, which then went into subsequent revisions of the questionnaire, and then were sent to all the countries in order to, or for the countries to do their piloting workshops. Data analysis. This was a bit tricky to figure out, because data analysis is quite a complex and technical task. We didn't have time to give them an intro to stats course, but we realized that that level of detail wasn't really necessary in order to get across how they could contribute to the analysis and do some capacity building with them. So when we met them, we spent some time talking about what it means to analyze data, sort of the general steps of the process, and we followed this, or concretizing it, using some activities involving quality streams, chocolates, and Lego to examine grouping and presenting data, and then looking at some data sets, some fun data sets about dogs to explore the idea of patterns and relationships in data. And then finally, we sort of took that introduction to those foundational concepts and had the kids bring them to bear on the questionnaires. So we had them basically go through the questionnaires and work with each other in twos or threes to hypothesize about the connections and relationships that there might be between answers to different questions on the questionnaires. So maybe there's a relationship between your migrant, whether you're like, you know, a non-migrant, first generation migrant, second generation migrant, and how comfortable you feel at school or your relationship with your teachers. Maybe there's a relationship between gender and your relationships with your peers. So those, getting them to brainstorm about those kinds of relationships. We took all of their notes from that session and we produced a preliminary report based on their ideas for the analysis, which was also shared with the team at Comillas, who are actually in charge of the overall quantitative data analysis. The next time we met with them, we shared their report with them, and they gave us even more feedback, which was again shared with Comillas. So there's sort of a nice little feedback loop about the analysis going on between the Comillas team who are doing the analysis and the advisory group. And that will continue with our next meeting with the advisory group in May. The advisory group has also had input into things like the dissemination of the results. Some of them will be involved in our end panels and all of that. But yeah, like I said, I don't have time to go through all of the stuff they've been involved in. In this last section of my talk, I'm going to reflect on some of the major challenges that we faced in trying to incorporate co-creation into Immerse, how we addressed those challenges, and what advice we might offer to others contemplating similar research, or what we might want to do in the future if we undertook something like this again. The first challenge was simply the scale of the project. As I mentioned earlier, it's not common to try and make co-creation a central feature of such a large, multi-partner, multinational, multi-year, high-cost research endeavor like this. We had little guidance. So most research that embraces a co-creative approach is much smaller in scale, it's shorter term, it has fewer outputs, and employs methods that are more amenable to co-creation. So let's just start with the application process. This in itself places limits on the potential for co-creation in large-scale research, because the process and the document itself, the application itself, are so intensive and technical and opaque. You need an enormous amount of expertise and familiarity with the process in order to navigate it successfully. I don't think that's unreasonable either. To be clear, it's public money and the founders are justified in ensuring that the people who receive that money know what they're doing. But it does mean that it's unlikely that you would ever have a youth-initiated or a truly bottom-up approach for a project of this scale. Could you have a researcher-led but with joint decision-making with young people kind of approach? That might be possible, but it would require a lot of facilitation just for the application. And I don't think it's reasonable to expect children to invest that kind of time and effort into co-creating a proposal for a project on this scale when it's not likely that it will get funded. Not because it would be bad, but because the success rate with funding applications or programs like this is very low. I mean, the success rate for Horizon 2020 was like, what, 12%? So the odds of securing the funding, even if you've got a great proposal, still aren't very good. So in reality, children's involvement won't start until after the project is funded. As Franks points out, by then, many of the key decisions have already been made. And these applications are very structured and demand a high level of specificity in your proposal. But both our experiences and the literature tell us that co-creative research with children needs a certain amount of flexibility. So it can be difficult to try and incorporate that into such a structured process. We found that trying to embed co-creation across all aspects of the project was pretty unwieldy and also unrealistic in a lot of cases. Again, the scale was kind of against us. Not all partners had the resources and the expertise to engage in co-creation, especially not at multiple points during the project. It can be expensive to engage in co-creation in terms of time and finances. Every meeting that UCC had with the CPEG cost us several hundred euro for transport, for providing lunch, for materials, etc. And organizing and preparing for those meetings also eats up a lot of time, as does arranging the policy consultation workshops, the questionnaire validation workshops. Anything to do with co-creation requires a lot of thought and preparation. Some of the project activity, a lot of the project activity was highly technical or purely administrative or needed coordination across multiple partners, things that children and young people may not have the capacity or the interest or the time to do. The length of the project also meant that having the same children involved from the beginning to the end was problematic. I don't know if you guys know this, but kids grow up. They move on, their interests move on, and we were dealing with migrant and refugee young people, so they often have little control over where and when they might get moved. So getting consistent involvement over such a long project was a challenge. We also found that our intentions as researchers and the reality of our young people's circumstances and their capabilities did not always match the expectations of the funders and those who were reviewing our progress. So how did we address those challenges? Though we didn't feel it would be appropriate to involve children in the application process, once the funding was secured, the CPEG was formed almost immediately after the project kickoff. I think we've also done a good job of being agile and creative in our interpretation of the original proposal, finding and making space for co-creation that may not have been originally envisioned, but became called for as the project went on. So, for example, it wasn't originally envisioned to produce child-friendly versions of the results of the reports, or to convene a new group at this stage to co-create dissemination strategies, but the need for both of them became clear as it went on. Our response to participation across the project being unwieldy and unrealistic was to adopt Frank's pockets of participation approach, though we didn't necessarily articulate it as such in the beginning. And I think this has been quite successful in terms of co-creation that is both practical and realistic, but still quite meaningful in terms of influencing the research process. We couldn't have young people leading a technical task like questionnaire construction or data analysis, but we have made them our partners in ensuring that the instruments are appropriate and relevant for their peers, and that our analysis of the data speaks to their concerns. We have also worked hard, led by our coordinators at Comillas, to clarify and concretize our co-creative approach with our project officer and with our reviewers, making it clear that it was never intended to be like a bottom-up or entirely user-led approach, but that we have demonstrated throughout a commitment to space and to voice, a la the Lundy model, and in the final upcoming stages to audience and to influence, the other two elements of the Lundy model. So having gone through this process, if we were to undertake this scope of project again, I think what we would want to do is build or more effectively build flexibility for the children's participation into the proposal using clearer models and language that we now have, thanks to doing Immerse, to express why the flexibility is necessary and how it will benefit the research. And we would also take more care, I think, to build specific costs for children's participation into the budget. For a project of such scale, I think the combination of Frank's pockets of participation and the Lundy model are really excellent guides, with Lundy as the framework embedded in children's rights and Frank's providing the methodological guidance. The second challenge was the use of quantitative methods on such a large scale. The questionnaire data is the cornerstone of the project. It was also the biggest set piece of the project. It has taken more time and resources than anything else in the project by far. But as I mentioned earlier, quantitative data collection, especially on a large scale, is not that amenable to co-creation. And it's relatively infrequently used to even do research on children, let alone research with and for children. So its design is more rigid, there's greater need for control and standardization, it's highly technical, requires a great deal of specialist knowledge, so it makes capacity building more complex and time-consuming as well. There are good reasons for all of this. Like, I don't think that these are arbitrary characteristics of the quantitative process. There's reasons for all of that. But all of it does mean that the social relationships tend to remain hierarchical, and it does limit the potential for children's participation and the creation of knowledge with them. So how did we address that challenge? This is an interesting one, because at many points throughout the process, because this facet of the project took up so much time, and the team at UCC were the work package leaders for the quantitative data collection, so, I mean, my memory of this project is going to be dominated by that, it often felt like we weren't doing enough to find and make space for co-creation. But looking back on it now, I'm actually really proud of the work that we've done, and I think it provides a decent model to build on from here. So again, this was about the pockets of participation. We couldn't have people leading the construction of the questionnaire, but they could critically review it and ensure that it was relevant, understandable, user-friendly. We didn't have time to get them up to the level of like running analyses on the data and SPSS, but we could introduce them to the foundational concepts and feed their ideas about pattern relationships in the data to the data analysis team. And I think it's worth pointing out again that we extended the regular participant potential in this arena by creating a questionnaire that could be filled in by children as young as 7. So our directions for future would be, again, to find and make those pockets of participation and to be realistic about what you will be able to accomplish, but not to let the difficulty inherent in the task deter you from trying to do as much as you can. And this is my last point. I promise I'm conscious of the time. But yeah, this is my last set of slides here. For the advisory group, as valuable as the advisory group has been, there have been a lot of challenges that we've encountered running it over the course of the project. And this is another instance where the length and the scale of the project presented problems. Originally, the project was meant to be 4 years. It is now stretched into 5. Even if it had remained at the original 4, we would still have had problems keeping the same group together over that length of time and maintaining their interest and enthusiasm for it. The children and young people were recruited through migrant community organizations and then through those organizations through their families. So most of the members didn't know each other before. Because of that, and because we met usually only twice a year for about 3 or 4 hours at a time, it was difficult to develop a sort of a strong group identity or group dynamic. Some of the members have aged out now, as I mentioned, miraculously, kids grow up. And so, you know, they've finished secondary school, they've gone on to other things in the intervening years. So yeah, maintaining that kind of consistency in the group was really difficult. Because of time constraints, busy schedules, restrictions on movement in the case of our members who were asylum seekers, meeting frequently was not an option. For the same reasons, scheduling meetings was also difficult. The meetings themselves have usually been on a Saturday afternoon for 3 to 4 hours, including lunch, which we provide for them. But setting up these meetings and preparing for them was time consuming. So, for example, the data analysis workshops that I did with them, they were really good fun. And I think both the CPEG and we got a lot out of them, but they took a lot of time and thought to put together. I've also mentioned that these kinds of meetings could be expensive to put on because most of the kids don't live anywhere near the university, especially the ones who are living in accommodation centers for asylum seekers. So there's transportation costs, providing them with food, getting all the materials together, all of that kind of stuff. Navigating communication could also be a challenge and became more of a challenge as time went on. Communication face-to-face was no problem. Once we could get them to the meeting in person, or actually even the online meetings, they were great. But for scheduling purposes, they could be quite difficult to reach. We tried letters just for the novelty of it. We tried emails, we tried WhatsApp groups. In the end, we've stuck with WhatsApp groups because that seems to be the most effective. But as time goes on, their interest in the project is waning somewhat. So that's also becoming sort of less effective. We've also found some of the ethical and representation considerations challenging. There was only one advisory group for a consortium of partners in 6 countries. Was that enough? We've also had to manage and negotiate with other partners and with the funders around the ethical use of the advisory group, mainly relating to expectations of what the group had the time and resources to accomplish. So I think in the enthusiasm to make the most of the co-creative potential that the advisory group represented, it was often suggested that they take on many more tasks and responsibilities than were realistic, given the time that we had with them and their own personal restrictions. And they were under the UCC team's care, so we were quite protective of them and their time, especially considering the project has now gone on longer than expected and their responsibilities have been more than what was originally envisioned. But this is where some of that agility and creativity has come in, for example, with expanding the policy consultation workshops to all of the countries and convening a new group to address the child-friendly dissemination. So that's a task that we were able to take off the advisory group's plate by having another group that was dedicated just to looking at that. So for the future and research of this scope, for this research projects that are, yeah, of that scope and that length of time, I think some rethinking of the structure and functioning of the research advisory groups is needed. A single group of children and young people with a stable membership across a four-year project is not realistic. So perhaps some kind of rotation built into the group with new members joining every year or 2 years, or perhaps different advisory groups for different stages of the process. We would also recommend recruiting from organizations and schools rather than families, as this seems to have some practical and some procedural advantages. Communication's easier, capacity building is more built in, group identities already exist. However, we do need to be aware, we do need to be careful, because it's possible that voice and self-expression might be more restricted in the context of something like a school. And there may still be problems with consistency in the group membership. In terms of cost, time, and logistics, I think just accept it and plan for it with the axiom that this will always take more time than you think. And also, as previously mentioned, build it specifically into the budget. Another recommendation we would make in the case of multinational, multi-partner research, we do think there probably should be advisory groups in more than one location to ensure representativeness. This is not to say that every partner needs to run an advisory group. It has to make sense for the project and for the individual partners, but having only one group for such a big project put a lot of pressure on them and on us as well. And we think having multiple groups would also help to ease any conflicts around high productivity expectations that may not be able to be met. And as with all research involving children, we don't really want to propose any rigid rules or models because we think flexibility will always be needed and agility will always be your best friend. And that is the end of my presentation. Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias, Rihanna. Gracias por esta introducción, abordaje y sobre todo por comentarnos en el fondo qué es lo que fue ocurriendo conforme todo el proyecto Inmersa a lo largo de esos 5 años y toda la trayectoria que fueron descubriendo. Todo ese roadmap, ¿no? El acceso a derechos, la parte del lenguaje, la parte del bienestar, que es tan importante, la parte de infancia, las conexiones sociales y sobre todo la parte educacional, sí que nos deja ver esa pirámide de bienestar, ¿no? Y esa manera en la que de forma social, pero de forma también antropológica y de forma psicológica, deja que los niños lleguen a determinados lugares y de esta manera puedan incorporar sus conocimientos. A mí una de las cosas que más me gusta de este proyecto es la parte de la co-creación y es cómo los niños no son el objeto de estudio, sino que son los expertos que brindan las experiencias que van a ayudar a elaborar todas estas mediciones, ¿no? Creo que por parte del investigador tiene que haber una conciencia, pero también tiene que ser muy afinado la visión que tenga sobre la actuación infantil, sobre la manera en la que el niño interpreta y sobre la forma en la que esa interpretación infantil tiene que ver con el mundo real y con lo que está ocurriendo. Y desde este punto de vista, creo que otro de los valores de esta investigación es que no se para y estudia solamente niños migrantes y refugiados, estudia colegio. en donde claramente los niños migrantes y refugiados forman parte de ese colegio y de esa sociedad, es decir, no segrega, forman parte de una ciudadanía y de una sociedad que está en constante cambio y que tiene una identidad determinada y a partir de ahí genera conocimiento. Y por ello creo que este proyecto es genuino y tiene toda esa parte, ¿no? Rihanna, nos hablabas de costes económicos, pero es que a cambio tenemos unos beneficios sociales que yo no sé si se podrían cuantificar en cuanto a bienes económicos y si eso pudiera, yo creo que es que merece la pena, es más que un coste, una inversión económica, esta parte del proyecto, ¿no? Tengo una pregunta y es, yo todavía recuerdo cuando nos confinaron, yo creo que de todos los que nos ven, nos escuchan y los que estamos aquí presentes nos acordamos y me acuerdo que el proyecto INMERS estaba despegando con mucho trabajo de campo y de repente nos encierran a todos en casa y me gustaría preguntarte cómo habéis afrontado esa parte del confinamiento y del COVID-19 dentro del proyecto. Y por otro lado, me gustaría preguntarte también, ¿cómo crees que, de qué manera dirías que la co-creación con niños representa una ventaja comparada con la recogida de datos tradicional, organizada, implementada, que es solamente para investigadores? Esas dos preguntas son las que me gustaría abordar ahora en esta primera parte de debate.
Thank you. Okay, so I just want to make sure that I'm right. So the two questions that you have were about basically the impact of COVID on the research, and then also what do we think the value or the ultimate contribution of the co-creation was to the research. Okay, I mean, COVID, oh my God, I could talk about how this affected the project for a year and a half, which was how long we were on lockdown. When COVID first started, we had finished the first phase of the project. So the dashboard was basically created, or we had all the material that we needed to create the dashboard. So when COVID first kicked off, the dashboard was, I believe the dashboard was almost finalized and we were working on the questionnaires. And so when the pandemic first hit, none of us knew how long it was going to last. We were all hoping that it would only last a few months and it wouldn't sort of interfere with our timeline, obviously cognizant of the fact that like all the schools had been shut down, that, you know, if there was any learning going on, that it was entirely online. We were all working from home. As time progressed and it became clear that the pandemic was going to be with us for a long time, there were, in terms of the quantitative data collection, we had to do our validation workshops. We had to, basically any meetings that we had with the CPEG during that time all had to be online. It was not ideal. They weren't as effective as our in-person meetings, but we couldn't just have no contact with them throughout that period. We had to rely on those online meetings. So in terms of the quantitative, it meant that the process of constructing the questionnaires could actually go on for a much longer period of time, which ended up being really great. Because it allowed us more time to incorporate the feedback and revisions of the CPEG, but also all the feedback and revisions that came out of the translation process, because we translated the questionnaire into 11 different languages, and that process of translation really exposed a lot of the vagueness and also potential for sort of cultural misunderstandings of certain words that we were using. So in a way that actually benefited, I think, the instrument. But even when we came to the point where we were ready to pilot the instrument and to start thinking about actually deploying it in schools, We were all still on lockdown. The kids weren't back in schools. Or if they were back in schools, they were sort of like in pods. No visitors were being allowed. So we ended up writing a whole new chapter to our fieldwork handbook about how to do virtual site visits and how to work around COVID restrictions. And we also ended up adding a whole new section to the older children's questionnaire about the impact of COVID on their lives. And so most of our first actual data collection and including our pilot sessions were all done virtually. So we would arrange things with the school. The kids would either sort of be like on Zoom like this, or they would be in a classroom together, and then we would join them via Zoom, and there would be a teacher in the room facilitating. So most of our first data collection efforts were done in a virtual kind of way. As time went on, we were able to, in most cases, get back into the schools, get back into the classrooms. But COVID also had the result of schools being very reluctant to participate. The schools were under so much strain. I mean, I'm sure it sort of feels like a lifetime ago and no time at all ago. There were just massive pupil absences, teacher absences, like everybody was sick. And the schools were overwhelmed trying to make up for these 18 months worth of lost learning. So that actually made recruitment more difficult than I think it otherwise would have been. I think we were able to respond reasonably effectively. As I said, the project has extended from 4 years to five, and that's definitely as a result of our delays from COVID. But I think once we were able to actually get back in, especially face-to-face contact with the kids and face-to-face contact with our advisory group, it made us that much more eager to have that engagement and to get that engagement in place. And I think the extension to the project, again, whilst not ideal for a lot of different reasons, has allowed us time to get better at this co-creation stuff and to be more creative and, again, agile in our responses to things like the CPEG becoming overwhelmed with tasks trying to come up with different solutions. The longer this goes on, the better we get at it. That's not to say I don't want the project to end. I really want the project to end. In terms of the value that the co-creation has brought to the project, it's really hard to quantify. I could talk about sort of specific instances of places where the working with the kids has directly influenced the research process. Piloting the qualitative workshop materials, like right at the beginning of the project, that was the first thing that the CPEG did. And I think it was as a result of that workshop that we started using the imagined child activities. Because their feedback about how the kids, especially if they've come from a background that has involved any kind of trauma or anything like that, kids might not want to talk about their own experiences. And so giving them the choice to talk about an imagined child rather than making themselves vulnerable was really important. Another really concrete way that the advisory group has influence what we're doing is in terms of the data analysis. I think when we started analyzing the data, we're not quite finished collecting all of the data, but we've got most of it now, so we've started analyzing it. And we have mostly been interested in how migrant background is affecting things, and breaking that down, across the whole sample and by country and all of that. But the advisory group was really adamant. It was like, no, you can't just look at migrant background. You have to look at gender. You have to look at age. And if you can, you need to look at how these things are working together. So their sort of insistence on that, paying more attention to the other demographic variables, and also, they didn't phrase it like this, but the intersectionality of those demographic variables, I think, has has definitely enhanced the analysis that we were doing. So yeah, there's a couple of specific examples of how it's benefited the project. But I think in a more general way, just again, having this expert advice to ensure that the way that we're going about this is relevant and important, and that it takes into account the things that the kids think are important. And so the results won't just be for other academics. You know, we're not going to find ourselves in a bubble with these results. I feel much more confident about that not only we are going to be talking to other academics, of course we are, we all like going to conferences, but and also it's not just in terms of like high level policymakers as well, but that the results are going to be applicable for teachers and school leaders. Like, these are things that we want to be applicable in school environments, like immediately, that they don't have to be filtered through some kind of policy process in order to come down to the school. So yeah, I think it's made us a lot more confident that the results that we're going to have and the way that we're going to communicate them is going to hit lots of different levels at the same time, not just that high level academic and policy level, but also the school level and the level of the kids and their families themselves. That's what I would say.
Muchas gracias, Rihanna.
Sí. Bueno, muchas gracias, Rihanna. Ha sido una exposición verdaderamente enriquecedora. También quiero dar gracias a nuestra compañera Eva, que te manda saludos desde la sala. Eva también participa en el proyecto Inmers aquí en España. Y bueno, la verdad es que podemos ver cada día cómo trabajan incansablemente y es un orgullo. Así que gracias a ti también, Eva. Se me ocurren muchas preguntas para ti, Rihanna. Pero bueno, habiendo escuchado todo lo que nos has dicho, a mí yo me quedo con dos cosas. La primera, como ha dicho Cecilia, que los niños y las niñas al final se convierten en el sujeto activo. No solo a la hora de que se les aplique una investigación o una política, sino que además son los creadores de los indicadores, que a mí me parece algo súper complicado, súper complejo y que requiere mucho, mucho tiempo, ¿no? En todo de hacerles entender, de hacer un seguimiento de que ese niño o esa niña se sienta cómodo, de que comprenda el procedimiento. Y a la vez me parece que el feedback que recibimos y que recibís es súper valioso, ¿no? Entonces, mi pregunta iba dirigida a, en cuanto a los resultados que obtenéis de la investigación, ¿qué es aquello que os han contado los niños que se nos hubiese escapado a investigadores, expertos, que bueno, a la vez estamos estudiando o somos conocedores de la materia? ¿Pero qué es aquello que os han aportado los niños en los resultados de la investigación, que se os hubiese escapado?
What have, so in terms of the results, what has come out of what the children that have told us that was new to us, that were maybe things that we hadn't previously considered. Let me think. I mean, this is something that I hadn't given much thought to so far, which again, and this is as a result of the SCIPEG really insisting that we pay a lot more attention to the other demographic variables and looking at on the older children's questionnaire, we spent a lot of time thinking about the question of gender and what response categories we would provide. You know, were we just going to go with male and female? Were we going to provide alternatives? That kind of thing. We spent a long time discussing that. And in the end, what we went with was basically, how would you describe your gender was the question. And then they could answer male, female, in another way, or prefer not to say. And we have had a small but significant number of the children who have participated in the survey have indicated that they would not describe their gender as male or female, that they would say in another way, or they would prefer not to say. And it is remarkable how different their results when it comes to feeling like they belong in school, their relationships with their teachers, their relationships with their peers, their experiences of bullying, how unhappy the kids who identify as a different gender are. And what I would really, we haven't been able to do this yet, but one avenue of exploration with the data that I would really love to go into is again that intersectionality, and see how if we have children who are of a migrant background and who also identify in a kind of non-binary way in terms of their gender, is that having a compounding effect in terms of their levels of happiness, their levels of belonging, and their relationships with people. Now, that's going to come as no surprise, I'm sure, to people who study gender and for whom gender, and if they work with kids who identify as non-binary or transgender and all that, that's going to come as no surprise to them, I'm sure. But that was not something that I had considered very much before. One of the things that I really liked about the way, because with the SCIPEG especially, we were constantly asking them for their feedback about the process. You know, like, how do you feel about how this is going? Are there the things that we should do differently? Are there things that you would rather do? You know, that kind of thing. And then also asking them, you know, like, what are you guys getting out of this? What do you think are the benefits of this for you? And why do you think it's worthwhile to participate in something like this? And they're so matter of fact about it. They were just like, well, you're studying migrant and refugee kids. Like, who else are you going to go to for advice about how that research is best done? Like, who else are you going to ask? We're literally the source of the information. So that matter of factness and that confidence about it, that their voice was worth listening to. And I really hope that is a sign of actually sort of the things to come for the younger generation. That idea that, of course, my voice is important and of course I need to be listened to, rather than assuming that of course my voice isn't important or of course I won't be listened to. And I'm sure there are lots of kids who do still feel that way, but it seems to me anyway that the kids who hold that of course I'm worth listening to attitude, it feels like that's growing, and I think that's it makes me hopeful about the future. Well, something that's come out of the results, that the quantitative results, the analysis that we've done so far, that has surprised me and concerned me, there are two questions. One of them was about expected education levels. So we had a question in the older children's questionnaire about what is the highest level of education that you hope to achieve. And there is some, and then sort of, you know, like lower secondary, upper secondary, college, apprenticeship, university, you know, etc. And there are some differences between kids of sort of non-migrant, first generation, second generation migrant in terms of their expectations of their education. But what surprised me even more was how many of them were like, I don't know. Who answered, I don't know, I have no idea what to expect from my future. And we can speculate about why that might be. And it'll be interesting once we have the data available to see how many of those kids who are answering, I don't know, are in an asylum seeking situation because of, you know, the inherent uncertainty about their situation and that. And then the other question, where I don't know was a really prevalent answer, which I thought was really interesting and concerning, was about the availability of extracurricular activities in schools and in neighborhoods. So things like sports, things like music and art and that kind of stuff. And we know from the literature that these can be really really productive environments for integration. So the fact that there are, you know, huge chunks of kids, like a third of the sample, who have no idea whether or not this stuff is available in their school or where they live, I think that's quite concerning and not something I would have expected. And once we have all of the data and we've been able to, you know, actually complete our analysis and all of that, then, you know, I'm sure I'll have more ways to answer that question. But yeah, those are some of the examples that came to mind. If Eva is there, she's more than welcome to to answer any of these questions too. If she wants, if there's anything she'd like to add, if any of the Comillas team are there and would like to speak up about any of these things, I'm very happy for them to do that.
Hi, Rihanna. But actually conducting some analysis, but we still don't have the final numbers of that. But yeah, it's quite promising. A lot of different areas and aspects to look at. So yeah, hopefully for May, June, we probably have something.
Yeah, it's quite an exciting process, actually, starting to analyze the data. And I think we're all really looking forward to the data collection being completed so that we can really come to grips with what we've got. It's like as I said before, I think the database is going to be one of the most important outputs of the project. I think there's so much potential there. There will be so much more to explore, even beyond the final results reports for Immerse. There's research and articles to come out of that database for at least a decade. we'll all be making our careers off of this one project.
Preguntas para las personas primero que están en la sala, también las personas que están acompañándonos en online pueden dejar sus preguntas en el chat, como ya había indicado Raquel en un principio. En la sala, no sé si hay alguien que quiera preguntar algo. Todo súper claro, súper. No, la verdad es que es un. Sí, el compañero. Ay, la verdad es que ha sido un proyecto bastante amplio, bastante concreto y completo, y yo creo que bastante bien explicado, ¿no? Por parte de Rihanna. Sí, por favor.
Gracias. Tomás Milton, de la Universidad Nacional Autónoma de México. Un comentario muy breve y una pregunta. El comentario, me da mucho gusto ver que están trabajando en cómo propiciar lo que es la integración, en este caso, de niños refugiados. No les quiero contar lo que está pasando en Estados Unidos, en México, en donde, por cierto, acaban de fallecer casi 40 personas en un centro de detención en Ciudad Juárez. No nos podemos imaginar entonces que se trabaje en medidas de integración. Bueno, dicho lo anterior, la pregunta concreta es, ¿señalas como investigadora las complicaciones que tiene esta metodología que estás aplicando? Que están aplicando como parte del proyecto. ¿Cómo hacer que este tipo de proyectos puedan ser autofinanciables o que tengan mejores recursos? No estoy hablando únicamente de gobiernos, sino también bajar recursos tal vez de organizaciones internacionales o incluso de empresas, o ya lo están haciendo. Esa es la pregunta. Gracias.
Muchas gracias. ¿Alguien más?
I'm sorry, I'm not sure I understood, fully understood the question. Okay. Gosh. this particular project was funded by the European Commission. The European Commission has a whole strands of funding that are dedicated to migration and integration. It's a huge policy issue for the EU, so they've put a lot of research funding into it. I did, however, allude to the fact that the grants are incredibly difficult to get. I saw a newspaper headline last year that was very jubilantly proclaiming that the success rate under the Horizon program had increased to 16.8%, up from 12% from the last time. And I mean, which is good, any increase is good. But yeah, the grants are still incredibly difficult to come by. Now, in terms of more local funding, I don't think I can really speak on what the situation would be like in Spain. I can talk a little bit about what's going on in Ireland at the moment. Ireland's very weird from a policy standpoint because they've undergone a massive sea change in their approach to social policy over the last 30 years. Basically happened within the space of a generation from having a very sort of Catholic view of children and families and not really having any truck with the idea of children's rights along with other things, other social issues like divorce and contraception and all of that kind of stuff. But the attitude of the government here has really turned around where that's concerned. So there is actually, there's funding available, but a lot of it is it's sort of like local level funding, like small scale kind of funding. And so what we're seeing happening quite a lot now is community organizations partnering with researchers at universities to apply for funding together. Because the people who are reviewing the applications like to see the expertise of professional researchers involved in this, and universities really like, well, universities here anyway, really like their academics to be involved in community work and in making relationships and partnerships in the community. So that avenue of funding is really opening up here. I'm not sure if that's also the case in Spain. The Irish government, about a month ago, for example, published a new national strategy, or sorry, a national action plan on anti-racism. And so there's a whole new program of funding that's available through that. Again, it's mostly small scale funding. And so it's for like sort of small community projects and stuff like that. That's sort of one type of funding that can be pursued. If we're talking about the sort of large scale funding for big projects, like on the scale of Immerse, there will be sort of national funding for that kind of stuff, as well as the European funding, but that high level funding, pretty much I think has to be done through universities. Although the funding bodies themselves are looking more and more at universities partnering with NGOs and other organizations like that. So having those, other sort of non-academic organizations as part of the funding bids, I think is being looked on in increasingly in a favorable way. And I think that might have been one of the attractive things about the proposal for Immerse, was that it wasn't just a consortium of academics and universities, there were the NGOs involved. Three of the main partners are universities, and three of the main partners are NGOs. That might have been an attractive part of it. Funding process. I can't speak for other academics, but it is one of the least fun parts of being an academic, is putting together funding bids. It's part of the job, I guess. And again, if anybody there has something they would like to add about funding avenues for Spain, or what the funding situation is like there, please feel free to chime in.
Sí, tenemos una pregunta en la sala. Estamos pasando el micrófono.
Sí, ya estaba encendido. Pues me llamo Murtaza Haidari y soy de Afganistán. Hace un poquito de que llevo el título de refugiado aquí en España y lo sé muy claro lo que una persona de refugiado o refugiada, pues lo que lleva con este título, pues lo veo muy algo muy especial de lo que hace el instituto sobre los refugiados, porque todo se inicia el cambio por parte de más de teórica y luego así se va a más al aspecto más práctico. Pues lo que pensaba de preguntar fue el resultado de esta investigación. ¿Cómo se puede cambiar la vida de los niños refugiados en distintos países como España o lo que sea, Italia y otros países? ¿O cómo podemos cultivar una cultura más positiva para integración de los niños refugiados en una sociedad que les reciben? Muchas gracias.
Well, in terms of the sort of legal rights that refugees have, this will, I mean, the all the members of the EU are sort of under the umbrella of EU law when it comes to the asylum process and how refugees should be treated and what rights they should have. But there's also going to be country specific things that are going on. But I think I am right in saying that in all European countries, certainly all of the countries that were involved in the IMMERSE project, that children have a right to education regardless of their migration status. So whether they are in the asylum process or not, they have a legal right to education. Now, how that actually works out in practice is an entirely different matter. In Ireland, in a way, we're very lucky because we're so on the periphery of Europe. You know, we're on the fringes of the continent, so we don't get nearly as many asylum seekers in Ireland as you would as the countries that are on the Mediterranean, for example, or even Germany, even proportionally speaking, get many, many more migrants. So in Ireland, we haven't had much of a problem being able to accommodate asylum seeking children in our schools here. But I know, and now even more from working on this project, that that's not the case in the other countries, that the capacity and the resources that are available and the supports for asylum seeking children in all countries, whether they, even though they have that legal right to education, is not always being realized in practice. Or maybe they're in school, but they don't have the language support that they need to fully participate, which is more than just unfortunate, because education or school is going to be the primary site of integration for kids who are in the asylum process. So getting them in schools and getting them being able to interact with their peers and experiencing the normalcy and the stability that being in school can make is incredibly important. And I would certainly hope that the policy recommendations that are going to come out of IMMERSE will go some way into really forcing that message home with our national governments and with our departments of education to understand how much of a setback even a short delay in getting into education and school can have on asylum seeking children. In terms of public attitudes, I mean, gosh, that's such a difficult question. And it's really interesting for me as a Canadian. I grew up in Canada, that's where I'm from, but who has now lived in the UK and in Ireland, and you know, who's, you know, grew up being a neighbor of the United States, looking at the way that public attitudes have shifted towards migrants and towards refugees and asylum seekers in particular, it's incredibly discouraging. And it's really difficult to know how to, because once the rhetoric that especially those on the far right would like to employ about asylum seekers, that sort of that invasion, that overtaking, you know, that kind of language that they use, how to counter that once it has found a platform that's incredibly difficult. I'm not sure that is something that we are going to be able to address with the results of our research, but I know that there are scholars out there who study the far right and who study their tactics and their rhetoric, and who have ideas about how to counteract it. I think it's really important, though, to understand that national governments need to understand that they have a role in this, and that they have a role in debunking false information. And journalists as well, actually, the media have a much more important role that they have not taken advantage of yet, in terms of debunking all the misinformation and in turning the tide of public opinion about asylum seekers. In Ireland at the moment, the far right is a very small contingent. They don't have a big voice or a big platform in Ireland yet. But, you know, we've seen what's happened in the United States. We've seen what happens in the UK. And there are people who are warning us, both scholars and also people who are, who work in migrant organizations, the Irish Refugee Council. I was at a conference quite recently where the CEO or the person who runs the Irish Refugee Council says the far right might not have a very strong voice in Ireland right now, and we might have in general quite strong support for asylum seekers and for integration right now, but that's ours to lose. We can't take it for granted that is going to continue. And again, as like I said, I think the national governments and the media have a much more prominent role to play in setting that agenda, but I'm not sure that they're taking advantage of it in the way that I would like to see them do. I really feel like I haven't at all answered your question about that. But yeah, gosh, it is a really difficult question and incredibly relevant.
Muchísimas gracias, Rihanna. Efectivamente, son muchas las vertientes que surgen alrededor de la parte de educación, la parte de las llegadas, sobre todo no solamente en el continente europeo, también en el continente americano. A nivel global, vemos que la migración y el refugio se convierten en un paradigma y sobre todo es una realidad bastante difícil de abarcar con una sola disciplina. Se necesita de la interdisciplinariedad para comprender toda la cuestión que cubre esta temática. Entonces, quiero agradecerte, Rihanna, por ceñirte a los tiempos, por esta enriquecedora ponencia. Ha sido muy interesante. Quiero agradecer nuevamente, en manos de mi compañera Raquel, al equipo INMERS, parte del Instituto Universitario de Estudios sobre Migraciones, de las que estamos muy orgullosas. Definitivamente las hemos visto trabajar a lo largo de estos 5 años y las seguiremos viendo porque hay una segunda parte del proyecto INMERS que no es tal, pero continúa abordando la parte de educación con niños refugiados y inmigrantes, que se llama Let's Care. Es otro proyecto, es un proyecto Horizon que comienza y además en el cual está el equipo INMERS incorporando todos los hallazgos que tiene esa primera parte. Entonces, en ello nos hemos convertido en especialistas dentro del instituto y seguiremos abordando. Gracias por vuestro trabajo y por tocar tantas vidas hacia el futuro, porque como lo decía, este es un proyecto que toca el futuro porque son parte de nosotros, somos todos nosotros, migrantes y refugiados. Y bueno, pues un año más cerramos este seminario Migraciones y Refugio con un deseo, y es que el conocimiento que aquí se distribuye llegue a todas las personas que integramos esta sociedad. Refugiados y migrantes forzosos es una categoría que no califica el grado de humanidad. Todos somos personas y formamos parte de la sociedad. Conocer las vulnerabilidades a las que se enfrentan y poder poner en distintas voces su trayectoria, sin duda, ayuda a que seamos conscientes del reto. Sin embargo, tenemos también otro deseo, y es que sigamos remando todos en la misma dirección. Quiero expresarles mi más sincero agradecimiento a todos los participantes, ponentes, moderadores y compañeras del equipo de la Cátedra y del Instituto de Migraciones con las que hemos organizado este seminario. Gracias por su compromiso y por su dedicación en la promoción de los derechos y de la protección de los refugiados. Agradezco también a Inditex y a la universidad por su compromiso con esta tarea. A lo largo de este seminario hemos tenido la oportunidad de aprender de expertos y profesionales y refugiados que han compartido con nosotros su experiencia, conocimiento, y hemos debatido y reflexionado sobre los desafíos que enfrentan los refugiados en todo el mundo, y al mismo tiempo hemos explorado las soluciones que pudieran ayudar a mejorar sus condiciones de vida. Espero que este seminario haya sido una experiencia enriquecedora para todos y que nos haya permitido ampliar nuestra perspectiva sobre esta importante cuestión global. Así que sigamos trabajando juntos para promover la solidaridad, la compasión y sobre todo la justicia para todos los refugiados. Gracias por su participación y los esperamos en el seminario 23-24. Buenas tardes. Gracias. Gracias, Rihanna.
Thank you so much. This has been an absolute delight. Thank you for inviting me. And I'd also like to give a shout out to the Immerse team at Comillas. They are they've been great to work with, even when we've been disagreeing about stuff. They've been great to work with. I was really hoping that I would be able to be there in person. But it didn't quite work out. But I'm happy at least that we were able to at least do it by Zoom.
That's good enough. It was an honor to have you even through these. And we hope to see you soon. I don't know when the project closes. Probably.
The official end date of the project is now November of this year. But my contract is actually up in the middle of June. I'm applying for a job here at UCC. So, you know, if you know anybody. so it's possible that I might get to sort of see out the end. And regardless, I'll be at the end of project event in Brussels. So I should at least get to meet up with some of my Comillas friends there.
Yes, for sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah, and thank everybody for your questions and for listening. It was great.
Muchas gracias. Bueno, pues con esto cerramos. Quiero agradecer también a los compañeros, que ha sido un gusto tenerlos, a Fede, a Elena y a Andrea en la traducción y la interpretación de este seminario. Ellos forman parte del máster en interpretación, en traducción e interpretación de esta universidad. Son estudiantes, están haciendo también sus prácticas, y de esta manera, bueno, como Cátedra de Refugiados también cumplimos con una función, que es la de unir al resto de nuestros estudiantes e involucrarlos con esta misión, que es importante. Así que muchas gracias también a nuestros traductores e intérpretes. Ha sido un gusto tenerlos ahí, a Lola Guindal, que ha estado detrás de todo este marco. Y bueno, con esto creo que podemos cerrar la sesión. Seguimos en contacto. Gracias a todas las personas que se han conectado. Buenas tardes.